here, hallelujah. Sometimes we get into the mentality that when pastor's not here, hallelujah, that there's not a work to be done, hallelujah. But you have to ask yourself, who am I serving, hallelujah? Am I serving Renee Collins, or am I serving the mighty God, hallelujah? Just because she's not here, hallelujah, doesn't mean we don't want kingdom still, hallelujah. Just because she's not here, hallelujah, doesn't mean we don't want his glory to rest in this place, hallelujah. This might be somebody's last chance. This might be somebody's last opportunity, hallelujah, to see the Father, hallelujah. We want his presence, hallelujah. We want his presence, hallelujah. We want his presence, hallelujah. We want his presence in this place, hallelujah. God, we thank you, hallelujah. We thank you, God, that you sent the breaker anointing, hallelujah. God, forgive us now for our complacency in worship, hallelujah. Forgive us now for sitting on you in worship, God, hallelujah. God, when we seek after you from this point forward, hallelujah. God, we won't give you half of us, God, but we're going to give you all of us, God, hallelujah. We're going to give you all of us, God, hallelujah. We're going to give you all of us, God. All of us, God, hallelujah. All of us, God, hallelujah. Accept our offering, Father. Let it be pleasing in your sight, hallelujah. Let your work be completed through us on today, hallelujah. We speak now, God, an anointing for completion of your people. God, let us know it for years to come, hallelujah, that this is the day, hallelujah, that you completed some things in our lives, hallelujah, that you released new joy, new anointing, new overflow, hallelujah. Let this be the day, God, hallelujah, that we look back to and remember the glory that you allowed us to experience, hallelujah. We thank you and we honor you. In Jesus' name, hallelujah.
Neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. And he shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger, and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil, for evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently consider his place, and it shall not be. But the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. The wicked plotteth against the just, and gnasheth upon him with his teeth. The Lord shall laugh at him, for he seeth that his day is coming. The wicked have drawn out the sword, and have bent their bow, to cast down the poor and needy, to slay such as be of upright conversation. Their sword shall enter into their own heart, and their bows shall be broken. The word of the Lord is already blessed. Thank you.
Good morning, Kingdom Grace.
Good morning.
Good morning, Kingdom Grace.
Good morning,
Kingdom Grace. As Minister Kennedy has already said, we will not sit on this service. We will press forward. We are in November. Let's finish strong. Let's finish strong. The promises of God are still here. Let us finish strong in November. Amen. Let's call the word.
Hallelujah. Before you sit down, hallelujah. You know, it's first Sunday and we do our hymn on first Sunday. There's a little slip of paper in there. What a friend we have in Jesus. Hallelujah. Once you find it, go ahead and rest on your feet. The song says, what a friend we have in Jesus. All of our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. What a friend.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
change. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Forevermore, oh Lord, you are my shelter. How many glad about it? Yes. Amen.
Thank you. Church family, we welcome you, and we ask that you come back and visit us once again. We are here to worship and praise our holy God.
Yes.
Where
Jesus Christ is King.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
All right, we're gonna go ahead and do our meet and greet on this morning. So if we can stand up and go and give someone a hug that you did not come to church with today.
Hallelujah.
Just to spread and show a little bit of love. Amen.
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 all should feel just a little bit better with all those hugs that went forth and the love shown. Hallelujah. We are now going to move into another part of worship this morning, which is our offering.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. The Bible says the Lord loves us. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So if we can prepare our offerings and stand when you have them in your hand, and we'll go ahead and read our affirmation. I do want to give just a brief testimony, as this has been a blessing to me. I was actually looking for a new job because I needed new hours so that I could be home with my kids a little bit more instead of working in the evenings. So I went ahead and I filled out applications and I applied, and I ended up getting a working interview. And the doctor was just really pleased by, you know, my performance as a dental hygienist.
Amen.
And so not only did I get the job, I was just looking for new hours. But not only did I get new hours, but I also got a $3 raise.
Woo-hoo!
I definitely that this affirmation works. So when you say it trusting and believing that the thing that you are hoping God to do for you in your life will come to pass. Amen. All right. Everybody ready? All right. Because we understand
our biblical responsibilities
as worshipers, we bring our hearts to God, recognizing that we return to Him in our tithes and offerings. Where our money is,
where our
hearts
is.
We pay the tithe because we owe God our vow. And we give our offerings, sowing seeds to reap fruit. We sow into our pastor to reap a prophet's reward. We sow into the church to reap kingdom benefits. As we cheerfully participate in giving and receiving, we have from the Lord jobs and better jobs,
raises and bonuses,
benefit sales and commissions,
favorable settlements,
estates and inheritances,
rebates and returns,
checks in the mail,
gifts and surprises,
bills paid off,
and bills reduced.
Blessings and increase.
I am out of debt.
My needs are met.
And I have plenty more
to put in store.
Thank you, Lord,
for teaching me
how to be a godly
giver
and receiver.
Bring your offerings to the
front. I trust you, Lord. In increase, I'm walking.
friend of mine said something to me. He said, I'm going to tell you something very important. When he said it to me, I was just at the service, a youth service. And he said, Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men, come on, finish it with him. Couldn't put together again. He said, now, it wasn't that he fell so hard and shattered to so many pieces that he couldn't be put back together. It's very simple. They were calling on the wrong king. He said, because I know a king that can put your life back together no matter how great the fall. Do I have any witnesses here? All right. So I went home. I thought about it. And I wrote this. Said you've heard this story once before. Oh, yes. About the famous one up on the wall. Yet fairy tales, they reflect some truth. Yes, they do. That sometimes happens to us all. Hey, so if ever you see Humpty Dumpty or anybody else who's had a fall, please tell them that he's mending broken pieces. And he'll be there to fix it all. Yes, he will. Oh, that'll fix it all. Second verse says, now all the king's horses and all the king's men, yes, they try, but they couldn't bring that the broken pieces of his life, yes, which shattered all his dreams. Oh, so if ever you see Humpty Dumpty or anybody else who's had a fall, please tell them that he's mending broken pieces, and he'll be there to fix it all. Oh, so if ever you feel like Humpty Dumpty, remember that he's just and oh, so faithful. Oh, and he'll be there to fix it all. Yes, he will. Remember that he's love and oh, so faithful. And he'll be there to fix it all. So tell Humpty Dumpty, tell everybody, tell them that Mary had a lamb. Yes, she did. And tell them that Jesus is that lamb. Tell Jack and Jill, tell them come off that hill, 'cause I found the living water. Yes, I have. Tell little boy blue, give him your troubles, he'll take your blues away. Tell Mother Hubbard, if you trust in Jesus, he'll put food in your. Tell everybody that Jesus is in them. Fix it all.
First giving honor to God, who of course is the head of my life. I'd like to thank Overseer Renee Collins and Pastor Emeritus Wanda Sprinkle for giving me this honor and privilege to bring a word to you today. Here asked me to bring this word, I was a little hesitant because I know preaching is not my gift. Teaching is, but not preaching. So this will probably be more of a teachable moment than a preaching moment. I don't know how to hoop. I don't know how to do what they do. But I'm going to do what God allowed me to do today, and that's bring this word. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for your word and for the eternal truths that guide us day by day. We thank you for all of the living word, Jesus Christ, and the sureness of his presence. Teach us how to turn into you so that your thoughts may be our thoughts and your ways may be our ways. Amen. I want to welcome our live stream audience and Periscope family. If you have your Bibles or whatever devices you might have, can you please turn to Luke chapter 22, verse 54 through 62? And when you have them, just kind of raise them up or give me a little nod or say yay or look on somebody else's or whatever it's going to take. I promise I won't be before you too long. It's Luke chapter 22, verse 54 through 62. All right, I'll be coming from the New Living, the New International Version. Then seizing him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter followed at a distance. And when some there had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down together, Peter sat down with them. A servant girl saw him. Seated there in the fireplace. She looked closely at him and said, "This man was with him." But he denied it. "Woman, I don't know him," he said. A little later, someone else saw him and said, "You also are one of them." Peter replied, "Man, I am not." About an hour later, another asserted, "Certainly this fellow was with him, for he is a Galilean." Peter replied, "Man, I don't know what you're talking about." Just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him. "Before the rooster crows today, you would disown me three times." And Peter then went outside and wept bitterly. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. My subject today is the restoration of a fallen Christian. Or in other words, you may have fallen, but you can get up. How many of you that are maybe my age or a tad younger remember the commercial of the lady that had the little thing around her neck, and she used to say, "I've fallen, but I can't get up." Uh-huh. Yeah. Or how about Donnie McClurkin's song, "We Fall Down, But We Get Up"? Okay. Well, remember the song Elder Jason just played for us? Well, that song, the scriptures, as well as the two examples I just gave you, are exactly where we are, or many of us have been in our lives, or we know of others that have been in our lives. And some of us may still be struggling with some areas today in some way or another. We all have fallen. We all have failed during the course of our life. Some have had a greater fall, like Humpty Dumpty. Others not so great, but nonetheless, you still had a fall. The previous read passages of Scripture is a tremendous event in the life of Simon Peter and a lesson for us all. It is a story of Peter failing and falling and being restored by the Lord. You and I today have failed and we fall down. And we need to know this passage of Scripture. Next to the plan of salvation, there is nothing greater for a child of God to know is how to be restored when we have not only failed the Lord, but we've fallen out of His grace. Now, I am a firm believer that when I teach, I back it up with Scripture. So there's going to be quite a few Scriptures coming at you. In Romans 3 and 23 through 25 of the New Living Translation, and Elder Jason was kind of like in my backyard this morning doing Sunday school, says, "For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Yet God freely and graciously declares that we are righteous. He did this to Jesus Christ when he freed us from the penalty of our sins. For God presented Jesus as a sacrifice for sin. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. This sacrifice shows that God was being fair when he held back and did not punish those who sinned in times past." Now, to me, that would be like God being God. You know, how easy would it have been for him to say, "Well, you know what? I've done everything I can do for these people. My kids don't want to listen. They're hard-headed. I give up. I've given them every chance to do right. They still want to do wrong. They just don't never seem to want to learn. I've had enough." But that's not our God. Our God doesn't think like man. And it's a good thing he doesn't. Else, where would we be? He allowed his son to come down here to be tormented, brutalized, talked about, rejected, and ultimately sacrificed for us. How unselfish and merciful and loving was that? So, how do we help the fallen be restored, and what does restoration or restore mean? I'm glad you asked me that. According to the dictionary, the definition means to give back or return to one's original state. To me, that's man-made. I like the biblical definition much better. It's to receive back more than has been lost to the point when the final state is greater than the original condition. More and greater. More and greater. The main point is that someone or something is improved beyond measure. And I'm sure we all want that. I mean, we sit and we talk about, "Well, I had to pay this bill and that bill, and I don't know where this money's going to come from." And the next thing you know, somebody blesses you with a gift you didn't expect. Well, that's restoration. That's more, and that's greater. And that's where we all want to be in our lives. And the only way we can be that way is through our belief and have faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And that's where he wants us to be. Now, there are many Christians who have wandered away from the Lord. Unfaithful members of the Lord's church have everything to gain if they are restored, and their souls to lose in hell if they are not restored. So what I'm saying is that if you believe and want to be restored, then you're saving yourself from going straight to hell. And nobody wants to go there. Nobody wants to go there. A lot of us are living in that right here on this earth. So what have we got to lose by committing our life and belief in God? It can only get better. In James 5, 19 through 20, it says, "Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns his back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins." Isn't that the greater reward? Isn't that restoration? Isn't that double and more? If God is willing to cover us from a multitude of sins, what more could we ask? That's the definition of restoration. Here we see when one is restored, it will result in his soul being saved from eternal death in hell, and the multitude of his sins will be covered and forgiven. By helping to restore the fallen, will create joy in heaven. Jesus says in Luke 15 and 10, "Likewise I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Our concern is in trying to restore the fallen demonstrates our love, our faith, and our courage. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1 says, "Brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted." So, if we are spiritual, we will do our best to restore those who have fallen away. The Lord doesn't want anyone to be lost. As it says in 2 Peter 3 and 9, "He is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." He has already paid the price for our sin by taking our punishment. He is eager and ready for our return. In order to return, one must repent. This is where we help the fallen to see their need to repent and help them to return back to the Lord. Now, as we get further into this, it's going to be a little bit more life applicable, and I'm going to kind of break it down to where we are now. So right now, I'm kind of giving you some solutions, but we're going to delve into the problem here in a minute. The Bible is full of men who fell, and most have been restored. Look at the stories of Peter, Paul, David, the prodigal son, Samson, Jonah, Cain, Absalom. Those are just to name a few. The Bible records the fall of many men of God. I believe that each Christian that falls, even in this, the 21st century, will in some way resemble these men. Each fell in a different way and for different reasons. The study of their issues and situations will go a long way in helping you to restore a fellow Christian that has fallen, even if it's yourself.